Morning, everybody. My name is Mark, and I'm an alcoholic. Let's take a moment of silence and then open with the serenity prayer. Thank you, serenity prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. We're going to talk today about the fifth step. And in conjunction with that, I don't know if some of you noticed over there, there's a picture that shows my lineage. If you think about it, everybody that sits in the rooms of 12-step recovery somehow all gets tied back to Bill W. and Dr. Bob, correct? They're the co-founders. You all are being exposed to that lineage. And what you'll notice about that lineage is there's Don Pritz, who passed away 2 years ago. Gary B., who's still alive, he sobered up in 64. Paul Martin, who sobered up on 8/15/1947. Paul S., Dr. Bob. So the message from the co-founder to me is not diluted with somebody's opinion about how you recover from a hopeless state of mind and body and how you can have power in your life, in every area of your life, far beyond just staying clean and sober. Paul M. is still alive today. He's currently dying of lung cancer. He's in his 80s. He's had more articles published in the grapevine than any AA member ever. And so there is an article here that I want to share with you all that ties into fourth and fifth steps. It's called Getting Honest with Ourselves. It says, Mike sobered up once again in January of 1972. He had bounced around AA for years with a pattern of many meetings, drinking, hospitals, jails, many meetings, drinking, and so on. He would stay sober for a few weeks or months and then return once more to that dreary round of alcohol and misery. Mike says, I never stayed sober for any length of time, and I never paid much attention to the fact that I was dishonest to the bone. Since that last drunk in 1972, I've been trying to live honestly, and I have been working the 12 steps, and I've been staying sober. I was around AA for 15 years before I began trying to live honestly and responsibly. Today, it seems obvious to me that these are fundamental requirements if I'm going to stay sober. Cleaning up my life by working the steps and trying to practice honesty in every facet of living enables me to see more clearly what is really important. It gives me a much clearer understanding of my relationship with God and with other human beings. I believe that honesty is essential for me to stay sober and become sane. It's heavily emphasized in the Big Book, and I never could stay sober or know what the program is about until I made a persistent effort to stop lying, stealing, and cheating. Although I stayed sober from my first contact with AA, my experience with honesty has been much like Mike's and that of a number of other friends of mine. If we work the steps, the program brings us sanity along with other solid benefits. To be sane means to see and report things as they are. It means to perceive events and surroundings accurately and then report them truthfully. Lying, on the other hand, clouds my perception of truth and will instantly impair my relationship with God. Lying about anything corrodes my ability to see the truth about everything. Let me read that again. Lying about anything corrodes my ability to see the truth about everything, because everything is connected to everything else, and dishonesty in one part of my life creates damage in other areas. There's no way I'll become sane unless I quit lying, stealing, and cheating. For me, being honest requires living responsibly and openly. Dr. William Glasser is best known for his book Reality Therapy, published about 15 years ago. Glasser wrote, people who are not at some time in their lives, preferably early, exposed intimately to others who care enough about them to discipline them, will not learn to be responsible. How many of you relate to that? For that failure, they will suffer all of their lives. No one in AA will discipline me, but I can learn responsibility in AA through openness, letting others know me completely by continual work with the steps, especially 4 and 5. Honesty, openness, and responsibility involve dual concepts. 1, to do what I say, and 2, to say what I do. So that's the best definition of honesty I've ever seen. Say what I do, do what I say. Doing what I say means that I keep commitments, I honor agreements, I meet responsibilities. If, for some reason, I cannot do something I promised, or if I find a good reason not to do it, then I renegotiate with the person to whom I gave the promise, rather than just ignoring my commitment or changing it without telling the other individual. Saying what I do goes back to openness, letting others know me at depth and keep them up to date on my life, reinforce my capacity to live up to the principles of the program. Allowing others into my life strengthens my conscience and gives me the ability to function on a better level. As with many useful concepts, doing what I say is important, but it's not always easy. It completely upset my life, says Frank, a Denver lawyer with 15 years of sobriety. I was sober 10 years when I began trying to practice this, and almost immediately I found out how dishonest I was. It sickened me, and it provided a powerful incentive to change. Until a person intends honesty, he doesn't realize the extent of his dishonesty. Looking at myself, I discovered irresponsibility, fraud, a constant failure to keep commitments. I had 2 tough years of working to improve and failing in my efforts. Because I'd promised anything in my work, there was no way of setting priorities or delivering what I promised. Doing what I'm supposed to in the program and in my life has invariably simplified everything. This happened once again with my efforts to do what I say. Trying to be honest and responsible has enabled me to live a more disciplined life that is at the same time simpler and far more enjoyable. In addition, I can accomplish much more because procrastination often resulted from my failure to honestly appraise the state of my life and what needed to be done. Frank's difficulties in moving toward honest, responsible living mirrored my own. I found that the second concept, saying what I do, was a critical part of the equation for change. I had lied so much about so many things by the time I sobered up in AA, I had confusion piled upon confusion, caused by a severely damaged capacity for seeing things as they are. Disorganized, disintegrated, and ineffective, I had a poor memory created by endless lying that blurred my perceptions of everything. Rotten work habits were only one product of this condition. Gradually understanding the critical role of truth in my recovery, I started aiming for rigorous honesty. Now that's been a number of years ago, and the time has been heavily scarred by my reoccurring experiments with selective honesty. Opening up with others became the key to increased honesty. Often simply being honest with others about my own dishonesty started me back on the road to spiritual health. Spiritual growth requires at least 2 commodities, time and energy. When I'm corroded inside with the trash of dishonest, irresponsible living, it will chew up my vitality. Over and over, I have experienced the vigorous healing generated by thorough 4 steps followed by honest 5th steps. Again and again, this has liberated a vitality for change and enabled me to pick up my life and move in the direction intended. There's another benefit to openness, of course. Persistent effort with this brings consciousness of one's real identity. We gradually understand that who we are is not dependent on someone else's opinion of us. It lies within us and not in the eyes or mind of another person. We come to know who we are and who we are not, and we start to live on the basis of the truth about ourselves. This knocks out all kinds of unrealistic hopes and ambitions. Martin Buber, the Hasidic scholar, used to tell the story of Rabbi Zusa. An ardent admirer of Moses, Rabbi Zusa constantly berated himself because he fell short of his hero. One night in a dream, a voice said to him, "When you die, you will not be asked, why were you not Moses, but rather, why were you not Zusa?" Persistent, continuing work with all the 12 steps emphasizing honesty, openness, and responsibility, dissolves the urge to convince others I'm something I'm not, because I start to understand that who I am is sufficient. I don't have to be anyone else. That's part of sanity too. Honest, responsible living, supported by the 12 steps and membership in the AA community, provides a climate for growth that delivers what we need each day. Decisions based on a realistic appraisal of ourselves gradually deliver us from the pain created by that familiar self-will run riot. As honesty expands understanding of ourselves, we begin to grasp the wisdom in the words of that improbable philosopher, William Mitzner, the cuckoo who is on to himself is halfway out of the clock. How many of you have done fifth steps? How many of you listened to fifth steps? Okay. I want to share with you how I do that. The way you get experience with writing inventory and fifth steps is by writing inventory and doing fifth steps. Your opinion about it is useless. Do it. The old Nike commercial. Just do it. I don't know exactly how many I have listened to over the years. I suspect it's somewhere between 150 and 300. Could be more. I've listened to. I have read inventory, I would say, a minimum of 80 times. So like everything else in life, the more you do it, the more experience you get, the better and more skilled you get at it. There are some certain things and procedures, though, that I always follow every time. And I want to go over a little bit of that with you. Probably one of the first things I do is I want to look at the inventory before they bring it to me to read, because I don't want an incomplete inventory showing up. So I like to look at the resentment inventory, the fear inventory, the sex inventory ahead of time. And then I schedule time for it. If I can, I like to do it in my house or some area that I feel is conducive to doing the fifth step. Treat it. The book talks about when you do a fifth step, it's a life and death matter. Now, I don't know what those words mean to you all, but it signifies it's very, very important. So I need to treat it with that level of importance, and I do. I sometimes hear about people driving down the road doing a fifth step. I do not believe that gives it the priority it needs to have. If, in fact, it means my life and death, then I'm going to treat it in that fashion. So I'm always selective about where I listen to fifth steps. When the person comes over, we turn to page 70. And if you have your big book, go ahead and open it up to page 70. And by the way, I want you to think about this. When I sit down to work with somebody, the big book, my big book and their big book is always open between us. And I do that for a host of reasons. One is I'm trying to teach them something, because if I work with them in that fashion, everyone they work with will be worked with in that fashion. My program doesn't work. My program gets me drunk and loaded. There's just the program. You hear people say in meetings, you know, I work my program. I always say I'm real sorry to hear that, because that won't last very long. There's just the program, and it's outlined in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, from whence all 12-step programs have sprang, and it works. So we open up the big book, and we look toward the next to the last paragraph on page 70, and I begin to have them start reading this to me in the first person so that it has meaning. So it starts to sound like this. If I have been thorough about my personal inventory, I've written down a lot. I have listed and analyzed my resentments. I have begun to comprehend their futility and their fatality. And then I like to stop. Who's written a resentment inventory? Okay. Jay, why are your resentments futile?
Why are they futile?
Futile.
Oh, futile. I tend to hang on to them.
Okay, that's one aspect. Why else would resentments be futile? Resentments are always about something out there, right? What's the futility of that? Yeah, do
you? Well, we have no control.
Bingo. We have absolutely no control over another human being, an institution, or a principle. None. Hence the futility of it. What's the fatality of the resentments? You remember that? Remember what the big book says resentments do?
Kill us.
Yeah, because they block you off from the sunlight of the Spirit, meaning the power of God. See, here's why. This is a little sidebar. I realize that a lot of you think that you're separate from everybody and everything. What if the truth is that everything is connected and you're not? Let's work on the premise that perhaps that is the truth. I hope a lot of you wake up to that truth before you die. Because when you die, you will be aware of it. Everything is connected. So, if I'm angry at Richard, if I'm resentful, not angry. Resent means to revisit. Anger's in the moment, it passes. But then the mind plays it over, the injustice, correct? Now I've got a resentment. Here's why you get blocked. Because everything's connected, and God is in Richard, so when I'm blocked from Richard, I'm blocked from God. One resentment. What if you have 50? Do the math. That's why it took me a long time to figure out why do resentments... Says the big book says resentments is the number one offender of meaning. A lot of you have relapse history. You all need to understand something. Every one of you is relapsing behind resentments. And the reason is when you get resentful... You are blocked from God. If you're blocked from God and go to a strange mental blank spot, you'll drink and do drugs, won't you? So I don't have the luxury of one because I don't have the luxury to be blocked. That's why a resentment is fatal for me. That's why I'll take pen to paper in the drop of a hat. Particularly people that have long time that I work with and sponsor. A lot of them haven't written inventory in years. They're so dry, if you light a match around them, they would ignite. And they're always packed full of resentments, which means they're blocked, so they can't be present. So I like to talk about why our resentments are both futile and ultimately why they are fatal. When you guys do your evening review, if your mind's still replaying an injustice that a number member of the community inflicted upon you, if this happens for about 3 nights, you better write some 4-column inventory to get free of it. So you guys ought to be doing a lot of writing while you're here. I can't imagine you wouldn't be. Whether you're writing about the program directors being here, I don't care. But I can't imagine you guys being here not writing some inventory almost 2-3 times a week. It talks to say, it says, I've commenced to see their terrible destructiveness, meaning your resentments. I have begun to learn tolerance, patience, and goodwill toward all men, even my enemies, for I look on them as sick people. Do you understand what the book means when it says, I mean, at this point you're at page 70 of the big book, and it's implying that you're awake to the fact that these people you're resentful at are sick. Do you understand what the book means there? Yes or no? All right. Let me ask it this way. If somebody was really spiritually awake and somebody really understood that we're all connected, would they ever do anything to harm you? Bingo. Because if I harm Jeffrey, I harm me. Who would do that except a person who's spiritually sick or spiritually asleep? That's what it means. We've all had things done to us by people that are not right and that are wrong. And that caused harm. Everyone in this room has had that happen. Those actions were not done by people who were spiritually awake. They were done by people who are spiritually sick, like us. So that's what the book's trying to see. That's the only way you can have patience, tolerance, and goodwill toward an enemy. That makes sense. Is to finally understand nobody is intentionally doing anything. All of the suffering and the wars and the killing is done by people who are sound asleep, who have no idea that we're all connected. None whatsoever. They are spiritually sick. And that's how it shows up. It says, I've listed the people I've hurt by my conduct. That was in my inventory list. And I'm willing to straighten out the past if I can. In this book, I read again and again, the faith did for me what I could not do for myself. Do I believe that? This time, by page 70, you should have some belief in that. Number one, you're here. Number two, you're sober. It says, I hope I am convinced now that God can remove whatever self-will has blocked me off from Him. Your self-will cannot eliminate your self-will. That's why when one of you says to us, thanks for the information, I'll take it from here, what you're really saying to us is, my self-will will now manage this, thank you very much for the information. Only God can remove whatever self-will has me blocked off from God. And the methodology you and I were given was write inventory, do a fifth step. Four and five, four and five, four and five. It says, if I've already made a decision, third step, and an inventory of my grocery handy stat caps, fourth step, I've made a good beginning. That being so, I've swallowed and digested some big chunks of truth about myself. Turn to chapter 6, into action. I believe there's seven steps discussed in chapter 6. So having made my personal inventory, what shall I do about it? You see how I'm reading this in first person? It says, I've been trying to get a new attitude, second step, a new relationship with my Creator, third step, to discover the obstacles in my path, fourth step. I've admitted certain defects, fourth step. I have ascertained in a rough way what the trouble is. Selfishness, self-centered is the root of my problems. I have put my finger on the weak items in my personal inventory. Now this next sentence is the line that separates a spiritual experience from therapy or clinical work. Now these are about to be cast out. If you don't believe me when you leave here, go sit across from a psychiatrist, a PhD, or a master level therapist. Say, look, I'll make a deal with you. I'll pay you $100 an hour. I want to explain my defects to you, and then you'll cast them out. They'll probably send you for a mental evaluation. However, this process, my experience is, they get cast out. What an incredible thing. They get cast out. This requires action on my part, which when completed, will mean that I have admitted to God, to myself, and to another human being, the exact nature of my defects. Your fourth column, third and fourth column, your fears, your selfish, self-centered sexual misconduct. This brings us to the fifth step in the program of recovery mentioned in the preceding chapter. This is perhaps difficult, especially discussing my defects with another person. I may think I've done well enough in admitting these things to myself. There's doubt about that. In actual practice, I usually find a solitary self-appraisal insufficient. I thought it necessary to go much further. I will be more reconciled to discussing myself with another person when I see good reasons why I should do so. The best reason first. If I skip this vital step, I may not overcome drinking. Big Book starts warning you in the latter steps that you're not going to overcome drinking if you don't do them. Time after time, newcomers and old-timers have tried to keep to themselves certain facts about their lives. Trying to avoid this humbling experience, they turned to easier methods. Almost invariably, they got drunk. Having persevered with the rest of the program, they wondered why they fell. Pay attention to that sentence, gentlemen. It's describing somebody who left a bunch of stuff out in the fifth step, went on with the work, and still got drunk. We think the reason is they never completed their house cleaning. They took inventory all right, but they hung on to some of the worst items in stock. By the way, my experience, the worst items in stock are normally tied into your sex inventory. Whenever I have one, someone sitting across from me and I pick up on a lot of fear, I have a tendency to address that issue head on. And I'll say to them, you seemed a little restless. You seemed fearful. Would that happen to be something on your sex inventory? 99% of the time they go, yes. And I say, well, let me share a few little tidbits of my experience. And I typically get done sharing and they smile and they go, mine isn't anywhere close to yours. Here's what it was. They get relaxed. Now we can do the inventory. I can tell you, having listened to Well, matter of fact, I asked a priest one time, I said, do you ever hear anything new? And he said, no, and I said, I don't either. There isn't anything any of you have ever done that hasn't been done by probably most people sitting in the room. It's not unique to you, I assure you. So you can let go of that when you do the fifth step. So it talks about, I only thought I had lost my egoism and fear. I only thought that I had humbled myself. But I had not learned enough humility, fearlessness, and honesty in the sense I find necessary till I told someone else all my life story. And we tell our life story by writing the three inventories and sharing it with somebody. More than most people, I lead a double life. I'm very much the actor. To the outer world, I present my stage character or characters. This is the one I like you to see. I want to enjoy a certain reputation, but I know in my heart that I don't deserve it. So the inconsistency between what I want you to think I am and who I really am is made worse by the things I do in my sprees. Coming to my senses, drunk or sober, I am revolted at certain episodes I vaguely remember. These memories are a nightmare. I tremble to think someone might have observed me. So as fast as I can, I push these memories far inside myself. I hope they will never see the light of day. I'm under constant fear and tension. That always makes for more drinking. Psychologists are inclined to agree with us. I've spent thousands of dollars for examinations, rehab, blah, blah, blah. I know but few instances where I gave these doctors a fair break. I've seldom told them the whole truth, nor have I followed their advice. We're the only group of people that would sit across from somebody, pay them to help us, and we would lie to them. You see what I'm saying? Unwilling to be honest with these sympathetic men, I was honest with no one else. Small wonder many in the medical profession have a low opinion of alkies and their chance for recovery. It's a critical in here you see the connection between honesty and recovery. Particularly the next sentence. I must, circle the word must, be entirely honest with somebody if I expect to live long or happily in this world. Rightly, now I'm going to get instructions on who to read this inventory to. Rightly and naturally, I need to think well before I choose the person or persons, highlight that, plural, with whom to take this intimate and confidential step. Those of us belonging to a religious denomination which requires confession must and of course will want to go to the properly appointed authority whose duty it is to receive it. Though I have no... How many Catholics in here? Oh, you can go sit across from a priest if you want. How many of you have ever done a fifth step with a man of the cloth? It's a great experience. Goes on to say, though I have no religious connection, I may still do well to talk with someone ordained by an established religion. I will often find such a person quick to see and understand my problem. But of course, I will sometimes encounter people who do not understand Elkies. If I cannot or I'd rather not do this, then I search my acquaintance for a closed-mouth, understanding friend. Perhaps our doctor or psychologist would be the person. It may be one of my own family. Don't think so. But I cannot disclose anything to my wife, to our wives or parents, which will hurt them and make them unhappy. And then here's another rule when you're reading to somebody. I have no right to save my own skin at another person's expense. So such parts of my story I tell to someone who will understand yet be unaffected. The rule is I must be hard on myself but always considerate of others. Notwithstanding the great necessity for discussing myself with someone, and maybe one is so situated there's no suitable person available. If that is so, I may postpone this step only, however, if I hold myself in complete readiness to go through with it at the first opportunity. We say this because we're very anxious that I talk to the right person. Now here's more instructions about this person that's going to listen to my fifth step. It is important that he be able to keep a confidence, that he fully understand and approve what I'm driving at, that he will not try to change my plan. But I must not use this as a mere excuse to postpone. So when I decide who is to hear my story, I waste no time. I have a written inventory and I'm prepared for a long talk. So I'm going to explain to my partner what I'm about to do and why I have to do it. And when I read inventory, what I'm about to do is go over resentment, fear, and sex inventory. And the reason I have to do it is if I don't, I'll die an alcoholic death because I'll be blocked from God. He, this person I'm reading to, should realize that I am engaged upon a life and death errand. How many of you read that sentence before? A life and death errand. What does that mean to you? Does that have any significance? Life and death, yeah. It has significance. Most people approach in this way will be glad to help. They will be honored by our confidence. So I need to pocket my pride. I need to go to it. I need to illuminate every twist of character and every dark cranny of the past. And then I stop reading. And now I'm going to start listening to inventory. We're going to start with resentments. What I do is I have them read column one. That's the name. Column two, I don't allow them to tell me a story. Give me the reasons. Why do you resent this person? Oh, they're arrogant. They're distant. They're whatever. I say, all right, give me your third column. Seven areas of self that are hurt, threatened, or interfered with. What was affected there? Well, my self-esteem. Now, I don't let them just say to me, my self-esteem was affected. I make them explain how. I don't know if you understand. How many of you have written inventory where your third column under self-esteem comes from because you had a low opinion of yourself? That's a form of conceit. That's every bit as conceitful as the person. How many of you written inventory and your third column revealed you thought way too much of yourself? They're both forms of conceit. On one hand, I'm playing God. On the other, I'm lower than whale shit in the bottom of the ocean. They are both forms of conceit. See? Pride is always in my third column. Pride is how others see me. No one should see that person doing that to me. I lose my reputation. Ambition, my third column. Ambition's what I want. I want respect. I want that SOB in his knees making amends to me. Whatever it looks like. Security. Security is what I need to be okay. Then personal relations. When I write inventory, personal relationships for me are about same-sex relationships. My belief system's about men. For example, how many of you have ever written inventory on, quote, friends? Male friends. Your third column is where you better see your belief systems. Because every one of you in here, quote, that has friends, you have a script of how your friends are supposed to be, how they're supposed to treat you, how they're supposed to act, and when they don't, you wind up writing inventory on them. That's why I don't have any friends anymore. I got tired of writing inventory on them. Now, I got a lot of pals. Here's why I use the word pals. Because my ego does not write a script of how a pal is supposed to be. For whatever reason, that word, I attach nothing to it. Since I started using the word pals, I haven't had to write any inventory on friends. Sex relations. That, for me, is opposite sex. My belief system is about women and how they're supposed to be and treat me. Right? Money. I am my money. Don't mess with my money. So that becomes my third column. And I pull that out of them. I don't just let them say, keep in mind, I've been doing this a long time. Some of you may write inventory and you'll say, well, I'm resentful of Dad. Why? Well, he was never there for me. I remember a guy did that one time. I said, well, let me ask you, were you born and you never saw your dad again? Well, no, he worked a lot. And I said, well, why don't you write the truth in the second column then? It's a lot different from he was never there for me to he worked a lot and was gone, isn't it? By the way, make your second column truthful because your third and your fourth column roll out about the truth of your second. So then, when I'm done with that third column, by the way, the third column, you better see where you're playing God. You better show up in that third column. God doesn't have low self-esteem. I don't know if you know this. And you aren't resentful of somebody because you're suffering from low self-esteem. You're resentful of somebody because you're suffering from a little bit too much. Right? Big Book says, I had to quit playing God. It, me playing God, does not work. So the way you and I play God, by the way, the next time you read inventory, think about this. It's a good exercise to help you see your truth. When I read inventory, I like to imagine myself a little small amphitheater. And there's a little stage and there's a big chair, throne chair, and I'm sitting in it. And I got this little amphitheater, and all the people who's on my resentment inventory are all sitting there. And I get to look at each one, and I get to read the second column. And I start to see how absolute and insane it is that I'm sitting in this throne chair telling these people how they're supposed to be, how they're supposed to act, and it's all about me and what I think I need and want. And yet I have absolutely no control of them. And what an insane way to live your life. And then holding them accountable. It's kind of like I used to do that every Sunday night, and if I really was honest, I'd send them all a script of how they're supposed to treat me and act and respond to me in the course of the next week. You see what I'm saying? Sitting up in my little throne chair and looking and pointing down there at Dad, second column. You're this, you're this, you're this, you're this. See in the third column how I need all this stuff to be okay. Right? Can't do anything about how they're acting. Then the book talks about there's this bridge that I take from the third to the fourth column. Said, I got to be free of resentment, so it'll kill me. So there's a bridge. And it gives you a prayer. And part of that prayer reminds me that I'm spiritually sick like them. So now we're going to start on equal grounds. And there's also what I call the realization. I like to ask myself a question. Have I ever done what I wrote in the second column that I resented? And the answer is almost always yes. Now we're on equal footing. And now I start looking, where were my actions in this relationship? Selfish, self-centered, dishonest, or afraid? Once again, I do not just write out the words. I look at the behaviors. Dishonesty, for example. Three ways people are dishonest or I'm dishonest. I lie by omission. I lie directly. Or I lie to myself through self-delusion. Self-delusion. So I like to look at that. I will have somebody read 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's say they have 40 resentments. That's a lot of them, right? I'm not going to listen to 40. Because that's a whole other form of pandering to the ego. I'm going to have them read 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of them to make sure they understand the third and fourth column. Because your third and fourth column better turn the second column into a lie every time. Now the second column's true, but your third and fourth better turn it into a lie. Otherwise, all my troubles of my own making, which is what the big book says, is a lie. And it's not. Once I see that they understand the third and fourth column and they can turn the second column into a lie, then what I have them do is, I have them give me the name in the first column, tell me what they resent, and then I stop them and say, now tell me the truth. I'll give you an example. When I first opened Mark Houston Recovery, I hired a man that I'd hired and fired three times before. Needless to say, I fired him a fourth time. So I write some inventory. And here's basically the truth. The truth was very simple. I didn't want to take all this time to interview and hire a complete stranger. So even though I'd hired and fired him three times before, because of my selfishness, my dishonesty and self-delusion, think he would change when he never has. So I hired him. That was my truth. I didn't need to write a whole bunch of stuff. You see that? I saw my truth immediately. It was about me. None of it was about him. So that becomes the resentment inventory. And then we're going to move on to the fear inventory. And when I do the fear inventory, if you have your big book, if you'll open that up. To page 67. I go back in. And by the way, I do this every time. Because I got this guy sitting across from me. It may be his first time to hear a fifth step or to listen. And what I'm trying to do is imprint upon him how he will do it the next time he does it with somebody. But the book is always between him, between us. And the book is going to tell us what we're going to do and the benefits of why we're doing it. So it talks about, notice the word fear is bracketed alongside the difficulties with Brown, Jones, employer, and the wife. This short word, fear, somehow touches every aspect of my life. Fear was an evil and corroding thread. The fabric of my existence is shot through with fear. And here's what fear does, gentlemen. It set in motion trains of circumstances which brought me misfortune I felt I did not deserve. Give me an example. Fear has a lot to do with you guys in relapse. And the train of circumstances is ultimately you wind up in MHR, and now you sit here and say you want to be somewhere else. Fear sets some trains of motions, right? But did not we ourselves set the ball rolling? See, the fourth and fifth step is where the spotlight is on you and you alone. No longer the word blame is gone. You begin to assume complete responsibility for your life. Resentment inventory, this incredible fear inventory. Says, but did not we ourselves set the ball rolling? Sometimes I think fear ought to be classed with stealing. Fear seems to cause more trouble. Now let me ask you a question. Have any of you ever stolen anything without a conscious thought of stealing it first? We always think about it, correct? Well, I want you to think about something. Anytime that you're into fear and you stay in fear, you're making a conscious choice to stay in fear. And fear is always about self-reliance. Now you get your instructions on this fear inventory that the gentleman should have written. So I'm going to review my fears thoroughly. We work here with the Big 12. Because I could, you know, when I first wrote my fear inventory, I probably had 200, 300, 400 of them, but you could reduce them 10 or 12. I have a fear of being sober. Why? Because I don't know how to do life sober. I have a fear of being drunk. Why? Because I lose all my rights. I don't know what will happen. I have a fear of growing old. I have a fear of living. I have a fear of dying. I have a fear of being accepted. I have a fear of being rejected. They basically cover almost everything. It's an interesting thing about fears. I have a fear of failure. I have a fear of success. Remember the time my sponsor, I said, well, I have a fear of failure. He said, no, you don't. You've been very good at that. What you're afraid of is success. So I wrote on the fear of success and I saw that it was right. Gentlemen, I want you to think about this a minute. You stay permanently sober and you begin to get on with your life and your life starts to take off, I assure you, you're going to run up against yourself. Because as this power moves through your life, more and more responsibility. Some of you are going to go on, you're going to get married, and you're going to have children, and you're going to have careers, and you're going to have more and more responsibility added onto you. If you don't have God right in the middle of it, you're going to run. Some of you know what I'm talking about. The more successful God has allowed me to become, the more I need God. Do you get that? And I see, I understand that. I've written way too much inventory. I don't know how I did what I did yesterday, and you all and all my staff in the world expects me to do it again today. I don't know how to do it. I really don't. And it scares me. It does. It scares me way, way too much. So I need God right in the middle of that. So I'm going to make a list of all my fears. And then it says, don't I have these fears because self-reliance failed me? And I see the truth of that. I'm relying on Mark. Self-reliance is good as far as it goes, but it doesn't go far enough. Some of us once had great self-confidence, but it doesn't fully solve the fear problem or any other. When it makes us cocky, it's worse. Now I have the guy read the fear inventory. Column 1, he reads the fear. And I say, why do you have it? I make him tell me. And we go through the fear inventory. When we're done, we come back and read these next two paragraphs. They are so powerful. Because here's your formula for fear, gentlemen. It says, perhaps there's a better way of what? Dealing with fear. For I am now on a different basis. I'm on the basis of trusting and relying upon God. Now, I don't know what kind of God you got. I'll tell you what kind I got. He's about 20 foot tall anytime I want. I put my arm right here. He puts his hand on my head and nothing touches me. Except when my father wants to touch me. Nothing, gentlemen. Ain't no whiskey touching me. Ain't no dope. Ain't no evil people. Nothing touches me. That's the kind of God I got. And I absolutely trust and rely on God. Not humans. Because humans just do what they do. They'll disappoint you. They'll let you down. Blah, blah, blah. God will never do that. And I got my arm right here and he's got his hand on me and his power. And God protects me and keeps me safe and gives me guidance. I never think about drinking. I never think about doing dope. Ever. I hope you get that kind of God. And that God is not punity at all. That God loves me unconditionally. God doesn't understand. God, what kind of God would punish you if you're going through life sound asleep, dreaming you're awake, making mistakes? I don't want that kind of God. But that's the kind of God I got in my life. Whiskey can't touch me. Dope can't touch me. Bad people can't touch me. It ain't gonna happen. Darkness goes away from me, gets driven away from me. By what? By this loving hand, this power that surrounds me all the time, that I absolutely trust and rely upon. Ooh, get you vibrating. I trust infinite God rather than my finite self. Check this out. I'm in the world to play the role He assigns. Some of you are assigning yourself roles. I really hope you let go of it. How's it show up? Where you go when you leave here? What you do? You're assigning yourself a role. Let it go. Let it unfold. I'm in the world to play the role God assigns. You know why I accepted that? Because when I assign myself roles, I don't wind up in good places. I go to nut houses. I go to rehabs. I get divorced a lot. I'm broke. I quit. I let God assign me the role that God wants to give me. It says, check this out. Just to the extent that I do as I think God would have me and humbly rely on God, will God enable me to match calamity with serenity. I never apologize to anyone for depending upon my Creator. I can laugh at those who think spirituality is the way of weakness. Paradoxically, spirituality is the way of strength. Now, gentlemen, here's the definition of courage, far different than what I used to think it was. The verdict of the ages is faith means courage. All men of faith have courage. They trust their God. That's courage. When she leaves and the job leaves and mom dies and dad dies and you're dying of cancer, can you trust God? You're at MHR and you want to be somewhere else, or you're lonely and you miss your family, so what? Can you trust God? Men of faith have courage. They trust their God. And stop relying on yourself. Can God keep you sober? You better believe it. Can God keep you clean and off dope? You better believe it. Men of faith have courage. They trust their God. Not mom, not dad, not her, not the money. God. That's the definition of courage, gentlemen. Best definition I've ever heard in my experiences. It's the truth. Men of faith have courage, and the courage is they trust their God. Right when your back's up against the wall, all hell's coming at you. Yeah, God, bring it on. Remember I told you, if God wants something to touch me, it's going to touch me. I don't care. I turn to God. Great pain, great suffering. So what? Bring it on. Men of faith have courage. They trust their God. It says, I never apologize for God. Now check this next sentence. Instead, I let God demonstrate through Mark what God can do. Wow. God demonstrates through me what God can do. You work the steps, you become a hollow bone, so God can demonstrate. My God, when I sobered up in 1982, I had brain damage, kidney damage, liver damage, looked like a bloated whale, and everything I own's in a duffel bag. And I do this work, and I get to let God demonstrate through me what God can do. Even to opening this place, to getting to travel all over the world, to talk about God and the 12 steps, to get a book published, to have money in the bank, to have relationships. I get to let God demonstrate through me what God can do. It's not about what Mark can do. Do you get that? See? Think about that, gentlemen. You get to let God demonstrate through you what God can do. Wow. What an amazing thing. See, it's not about you anymore. Our part is easy. Do the steps. Take the course of action. And the rest is done to you and through you. Do you get that? You've all been trying to do way too much of this. Our part is simple. Our part is just go to the gym. 2 months later, you go, wow, I'm buff. It's that simple. Seriously, it's that simple. The big book's the trainer. Go to the gym. Do it. Boom. Wow, I'm benching 250. How'd that happen? See? Steps are the same way. If you're tired of the life you're living, if you're tired of what's been going on, do this. Watch what happens. Let God demonstrate to you what God can do. Powerful stuff. Now I get an exercise. I ask God to remove my fear and direct my attention to what God had me be. Your third step decision. In the third step, you made an agreement with the Creator of the universe about what you would be. Here's the agreement. I agreed with God, who I'm already a part of, that God would be my father, my employer, that I would be His child, and that I would be His actor. So anytime I'm afraid, I ask God to remove the fear and remind me what I'm supposed to be. Be, not do, but be. And the promise is at once I will commence to outgrow fear. That's all I got. Thank you. God bless you.